So it's my pleasure to welcome Mark Briers to MSR to give a talk today entitled Turing Days in Cybersecurity. Mark is a program director of security at the Alan Turing Institute. Prior to that, he worked for 16 years in the defense industry, primarily in the areas of statistical data analysis. His research interests include scalable Bayesian inference, sequential inference, and anomaly detection, particularly in the areas of cybersecurity. So thank you for presenting the talk today, Mark.
No, thank you. Thank you for inviting me, and thank you for coming here on an early, is it Wednesday? Wednesday or Thursday, I've lost count of what day it is, jet lag and whatever. So thank you for hosting me today. So what I want to do is to split this talk essentially into three parts. I think I changed the talk title as well, just to keep us all on our toes. So what I want to do is to discuss the Alan Turing Institute and introduce that to your organization and hopefully motivate you, inspire you, convince you that it's a worthwhile opportunity to collaborate with us, if that's of interest to you guys. And then kind of, in some sense, this segue from Turing and the Turing Institute and Alan Turing, the man, into the use of Bayesian statistics in the context of security-related applications and Turing's work at Bletchley Park. So there's a couple of slides on that and some relatively recent publications of Alan Turing's that have been declassified and pushed out there that not many people are aware of, which demonstrate Turing's use of Bayes, which is quite cool in my opinion. And then finally, try to kind of, there's so many tenuous links in this talk, but finally link the kind of Bayesian story to my work in cybersecurity and give you an overview of what I'm trying to achieve with the work at the Institute in the context of cybersecurity. My background is I'm a statistician by kind of PhD, specifically sequential Monte Carlo. That was the subject of my PhD thesis. And so you'll see lots of use of those kinds of algorithms. And I've been taught Bayesian statistics from an undergraduate level. And so all I know is Bayes. So if there's a question, my solution is a Bayesian solution. So I will make a slight apology for being completely kind of short-sighted in my approach to things. So the Alan Turing Institute, I've got a few slides on the Alan Turing Institute. So we are a charity in the UK, and we were set up by the UK government, or formally announced in March 2014. And what was happening in the UK and perhaps around the world, but specifically in the context of the UK landscape, there was lots of work being done in data. Well, I guess we'd now call it data science. Perhaps we'd even call it artificial intelligence, given the kind of evolution of the tags that get attached to these kinds of data-related activities. But back in the day, it was referred to as big data. And so there are lots of different initiatives, research initiatives, or application-related initiatives happening in academia and in industry. And there's lots of fragmentation even within the UK. So the UK government was particularly keen to ensure that UK society and UK PLC can benefit from these activities. And so they set up a national institute for data science and artificial intelligence related research to provide national level leadership and ensure that UK society and in collaboration with our international partners internationally, we can benefit from research activities taking place in these areas. So the institute, you can think of as sitting at the center of two networks. On one hand, we've got a network of academic-related institutions, and I'll talk about that in more detail shortly. And on the other side, we have a number of industry or government-related partners through which we try to kind of get real-world problems and ensure that our research has real-world applicability. And our job is essentially to try to kind of make some sense out of all the stuff that's going on in academia and industry, connect things up, and provide strategic leadership at the national level. Alongside that, we're also expected to train and educate everybody from some of my relatives who know nothing about data science all the way through to professors who want to know more about a specific specialized area. So we're expected to kind of provide training and education as well. So we've got quite a big remit. And we get a reasonable amount of funding from central government, which is actually funneled through one of our research councils, similar to the NSF, I guess. So we're considered to be a strategic government investment. And that means that we're kind of, you know, we're not We're not considered to be predatory in any sense because we are a charity. We've got some charitable goals around social good and training and education. People don't see us as a threat, a commercial threat or otherwise. They see us as a way in which they can utilize our expertise and the expertise that we bring in to benefit their organizations. And in doing so, we can benefit or we can align ourselves to our charitable goals. So we've got a network of university partners, and I'll describe how that works in a moment. But these are the university partners that we have at the moment. So we started off with 5 universities when we were initially created. So we were announced by George Osborne, who was our Chancellor of the Exchequer, back in 2014. We kind of started in 2016 really doing any kind of activity. So October 2016, so we're about 2 years old now. We started with 5 universities. So we had a competition in the UK to decide the 5 best universities in data science and AI, and the top 5 won. And there'd be no surprises there in terms of the kinds of names. These are household names in some respects. And then in the past 6 months, we've increased our network with 8 more universities. We're now up to 13 universities, if I can count. And what we do is we essentially second academics from these universities to work with us and provide us with the intellectual capital that we need to be able to undertake the research activities that we wish to undertake. And I'll kind of touch upon that, like I say, in a moment. Just to show you that we're not London-centric. So the cool thing is that, well, I think it's cool. The cool thing is that the Alan Turing Institute's kind of headquarters is based in the British Library in London. So if you ever get across to London, then do please drop me an email. My email address is on the final slide. And come and visit us because we have the British Library has some cool artifacts. So Magna Carta's hosted there, and we actually have an iPad coffee machine, which is another cool thing. Maybe it's not so cool in Microsoft. You may have those kinds of things, but in the UK that's kind of unique. So it's one of the kind of attracting things. So Magna Carta and iPad coffee machine. If they can't attract you over to the UK, then I don't know what will. And so we're based in London. And we have 2 university partners, also based in London, UCL and Queen Mary. And then we have kind of universities based around the country. And so we have offices in each one of these locations. And I suspect we'll have representation in Northern Ireland and in Wales in relatively short time scales as well. Or I hope that from a personal perspective, so that we have full geographic coverage across the UK. In terms of, so that's the kind of academic side. In terms of the partners that we have, so when we first started, again, we had 4 partners initially. And so these were kind of at launch. These were the types of organizations that we were working with. So Lloyd's Register Foundation, they are a charity themselves, and they own Lloyd's Register, which is an insurance company. That's a commercial entity, but the profits from the commercial entity, as I understand it, feed back into the charity, and the charity's mission is to essentially make the world a safer place in which to live. And I guess that benefits the insurance arm of the organisation. So Lloyd's Register are particularly interested in, they call it data-centric engineering, so engineering of critical national infrastructure to ensure the safety and integrity of those kinds of infrastructure, maximise that. Intel are interested in kind of co-designing chipsets and new algorithms, guests to generate and optimize their sales. I lead the interaction primarily with these organizations, so GCHQ, which is the UK equivalent of NSA, our Ministry of Defence and the Ministry of Defence Research Arm, which is Defence Science Technology Labs, DSTL. And then finally, one of our partners was HSBC, and I've been told many stories about HSBC, but allegedly, HSBC has 20% of the world's financial transaction trade flow data going through their books. And so that's quite a lot of data, and they want to do lots of good things with that data. And so there's a cool partnership happening with HSBC. I won't go through all of these because I realize it's a little bit boring. The partnership with Microsoft is kind of one way a present. So we are very grateful to Microsoft for providing us with £1 million worth of Azure credits a year to do cool stuff. But that's kind of where the relationship ends. You give us £1 million worth of credits and that's more or less it. So part of my motivation for being here is to try to kind of reach out beyond that, those Azure credits, and make some kind of meaningful attempt at collaboration. Some of you may know Andrew Blake, who is the director of Microsoft Research Cambridge, as I understand it. A few years ago, he was our initial director at the Institute, and Andrew's now moved on to bigger and better things, I'm told. And so there is a link between MSR and MSR Cambridge, at least, and the Institute in London. But like I say, I'm really keen to kind of develop those this relationship. So as I go through this presentation, if anything takes your fancy, then please do contact me, and I can arrange to link you up with the specific academics or at a more general level. So in terms of how we're structured, how many people we have, we're not at the MSR kind of size, sadly, but we do have a reasonable amount of people, at least by UK standards. So we have 250 or over 250 Turing fellows. So we kind of we have to use the word Turing in front of everything. That's the kind of brand that we attach ourselves to. So what that means? That means that we second in academics from our 13 partner universities. So these would be professors all the way through to junior academics working with us for 1, 2, 3 days a week on specific research projects or doing some of our teaching with us or appearing on House of Lords committees or trying to shape public policy and do lots of different activities. We actually get them to do quite a lot of work for us in lots of different ways. And it's an amazing academic community. So from the 13 best UK universities, we've then selected the 250 or so best academics in this area to work with us. So we have a really great pool of academics working with us, and some of the names, I won't list them because I don't want to show you, demonstrate my favorite academics, but some of the names I hope you will have come across. We have 19 of our own research fellows, which really translates into postdocs. We have about 50 PhD students. We have an internship program, which is running at the moment, which I'll come back to at the end, over the summer period. We have quite a lot of visiting researchers from academia, industry, and governments. And the UK government, in response to Brexit, has introduced a scheme called Rutherford Fellows. And what that is trying to do is to demonstrate that the UK is an open country, which I hope we always will be, and they fund senior, well, great academics or great researchers, not academics, great researchers from around the world to come and spend up to a year in the UK working at different research organisations or in industry. And so the Turing Institute has been given quite a bit of money to attract lots of people into the UK. So we've got 6 or 7 people from the US actually come across, so people from statisticians, for instance, from CMU. Are working with us and spending 6 months or so with us. So if there's any interest in that, I'm not quite sure what Microsoft's position on that would be, but if that's of interest, then we have the ability to kind of fund people to come across and spend a significant amount of time or a reasonable amount of time working with us. We have our own, we call them research engineers, software engineers that are of more academically minded than your average software engineer. We have a reasonable sized admin team because to manage 250 academics, you almost need 500 size admin team. But we didn't go to that order of magnitude. We settled at 50. And we have 7 program directors. So I'm one of the program directors at the Institute. We will have 8 eventually. And that aligns to our 8 programs and 8 challenges. So the program directors essentially control or lead the research at the Institute, aligned to one of these 8 thematic areas. And this is a slide that's been created by the marketing department. So you can tell they get less and less technical as the marketing department get more and more involved. I should remember that this has been publicly released as well, just in case the marketing department watch this presentation. It's a great, fantastic slide. It's not the most technical slide I've ever given. So we're doing work in healthcare. As I mentioned, we're doing work in engineering. I lead the work that we do in security. We do work on economics with using HSBC data, but again, focusing on our charitable objectives around social good and education. We have quite a big thrust or big interest in ethics and making machine decisions fair, transparent, and ethical. I kind of touched upon this in terms of our interactions with Intel and designing computers and chipsets and algorithms, kind of co-designing those two. We're doing work in science and humanities, and we are trying to foster government innovation. I've still not figured out what that actually means, but we're trying to make government more efficient in every sense of the word. So in terms of, as you guys I'm sure know, statistics, data science, artificial intelligence, call it what you like, computer science, I suppose, has general applicability. And we were set up as this national institute to derive benefit from all the work that we undertake. And so what we decided to do was focus on these eight application areas, essentially. And we believe with the partners that we have, if we do make positive impacts in one or more of these eight areas, then we'll be able to meet our charitable objectives. So we focused on eight areas, which doesn't feel like that much focus because actually each one of these areas is huge in itself. But it's a level of focus. It's as much focus as we can kind of give ourselves at present. We have a little bit of technical focus, although that the kind of scientific strategy is still emerging. And I'll kind of propose a scientific strategy, or rather a focus where I think the Institute is kind of best placed to contribute scientifically. And that builds on Alan Turing's legacy, in my opinion, or one of his many contributions to the scientific literature. But I'll come on to that in a moment. In terms of some of the applied research projects, so again, I'll just give you a kind of very high level overview of the types of things we're doing. And if any of these are of interest, the publications on our website, we open source all of the software that we generate, essentially everything. We believe in reproducibility, we believe in openness, etc. So we're trying to push everything out there so that people can benefit from the work that we do. So just to give you a little bit of an insight into the work that we do, so some of them are self-explanatory. So Digital Twin, this is related to the work that we're doing with the Lloyd's Register Foundation. So apparently there's a 3D printed bridge being placed in Amsterdam. And they're putting sensors all over this bridge. And there's quite a cool video that I don't have on my laptop of this bridge actually being printed. But they don't really understand, as I understand it, they don't really understand the long-term structural integrity or structural properties of this bridge and how it's going to degrade as a function of time and so on. But they're instrumenting it with lots of sensors. And so this project's all about trying to make sense of that data and making sure that the bridge can hold people or vehicles or whatever it's trying to hold. So it's quite an important project from that perspective. But as we start to 3D print more bridges, which I suspect will happen in time, we need to be able to understand the types of data that are coming from this type of system. The National Economy Dashboard. So this is where we're utilizing the HSBC data. So this is, so the UK government, I'm told, has a good understanding of how much trade flows, say, between the UK and the US, because we know how much stuff goes over our borders. But actually, they don't know how much trade flows between London and Manchester, because there's just not an easy way of measuring that. And so the HSBC data gives us a proxy to measuring trade flows between different geographical areas in the UK, and that allows us to essentially to produce local GDP figures almost and optimize national level kind of economic strategies associated with the different kind of flows of trade, for instance, between different major cities in the UK. So that's given the kind of the finance part of the government an ability to optimize their interventions. And I'm sure there's a kind of political dimension to that, but I would hope that they make all the decisions based on the data that's in front of them. But I suspect that's not always the case. I guess I won't go through all of these because I realize it's kind of a bit dull and I've sat in the audience listening to these kinds of talks myself, so I won't bore you too much. But like I say, if there's anything on that slide that's of interest, then please do contact me or visit our website, choring.ac.uk, and you can find out more details. In terms of the work that I lead, and I ask the academics or work with the academics to undertake, there's I've got three multi-year research projects happening at present. And so GARD, I think what we did here was actually get the acronym and then figure out what the name of the project was retrospectively. Anyway, essentially GARD is about predicting conflict. So it's a combination of graph theory and incorporating into those graphical-based representations, some stochastic differential equations to model things as a function of time, and integrating lots of different data sets to be able to predict areas that are susceptible to conflict. And that could be, so we've been working with the Colombian governments, for instance, on looking at different drugs cartels and how they interact or how they shoot each other, and then suggest intervention strategies based on the geographical topology and some of the work that we've been doing, and saying, right, okay, if you insert a roadblock in this location, then that's likely to kind of reduce the amount of shootings or interactions between these different groups, all the way up to the kind of international level. So, you know, these types of areas are likely to be susceptible to conflict in the future. And critically, because I'm a Bayesian, obviously, I slap prior distributions over everything, and we quantify the uncertainty with everything that we do. Which is kind of cool. So that's a project that's an interaction between Warwick, so Turing Institute's Warwick University and University College London. ADA is a bit like DARPA's D3M project, but D3M is on a completely different financial kind of scale, as you'd expect, because when DARPA invests, they invest big, whereas when we invest proportionately to how much money we've got in the bank. So this project is an interaction between Cambridge, Edinburgh, and Oxford universities and the Turing Institute. And basically what we're trying to do is to semi-automate part of the data wrangling process. So we're looking at, it's a lot of Gaussian process stuff. If you've seen Zubin Garamani talk about the automated statistician and model selection in Gaussian processes, essentially that's kind of what we're doing in this space. And then finally, in terms of on this slide, computing in trusted environments. So what we're doing there is utilizing Intel's SGX technology. So we've just released a SGX compliant Linux kernel library, so SGX LKL, or LKL SGX, can't remember which way around it is. And sitting on top of that SGX compliant Linux kernel library, we've actually placed Spark. And you may think that's a trivial operation, but the memory footprint in SGX is quite small. And so the interactions that one has to do to get Spark sitting, and even just the JVM sitting inside of SGX, essentially an encrypted memory, is quite significant. And so what that is now giving us an ability to do is to run containers, secure containers, essentially, in cloud-based infrastructure. And scale out using Spark's scalability properties. And essentially, we've got full end-to-end encryption now. We've got encryption at rest, and we have encryption using SGX when data and processing capability is in memory. So that's quite cool. So we're partnered with, so that's Cambridge, Imperial College, Turing Institute, and we have interactions with Docker. And in fact, we have interactions with MSR Cambridge on that particular project too. So that's what we're doing there. And I promise I'll get to some kind of technical content at some point soon. And then I've kicked off, a lot of these projects have now ended, but I kicked off a bunch of projects, short projects. So those previous projects are all multi-year projects. These were all six-month projects. So adversarial machine learning is of great interest to many people. What we're doing there is Bayesian deep learning. Not just because I'm a Bayesian, actually, the guy that ran this project is also a Bayesian, so that's why I thought it was that's a great idea. So it was a natural combination of things. But what we've been doing there is essentially spotting out-of-distribution data points and quantifying the probability that those kinds of data points are adversarial-related or adversarially generated. We've been doing some work with the National Cybersecurity Center. So GCHQ has an arm of GCHQ, which is called the National Cybersecurity Center, and they're tasked with ensuring the UK is safe from a cybersecurity perspective. And so we've been doing some cool work around DMARC, analyzing DMARC data and analyzing different interesting data sets to characterize the UK government's web footprint. And that, you may think that's easy, but actually when a fire station in the middle of the countryside, in the middle of nowhere in the UK, sets up a website on GoDaddy or wherever and pays them £20. You don't necessarily always know that that website's been created from a central government perspective, yet you're responsible for ensuring that the government's responsible for ensuring that it's protected to some extent. And so we've been trying to help them to understand that work. And the final piece I'll touch upon is evaluating homomorphic encryption. So we've just open sourced a software platform, which we call SHEEP. I can't remember what the acronym stands for, but it's one of these nice recursive acronyms. And what that is, it's taking homomorphic encryption primitives, so the addition multiplication operations and the different implementations of those, and actually providing a benchmarking platform through which people, you know, the clever mathematicians generate a new FHE-related algorithm, they can push it on this platform and then compare and contrast the kind of runtime performance as well as some of the mathematical assumptions that are baked into these different algorithms. And so we noticed that in the multi-party computation world, there's a benchmarking platform, but there wasn't one in the FHE world. And so we've now generated this platform. There's a paper just at ICML on this platform, and hopefully we'll see some adoption of that. So the reason I mention that is obviously it's a bit of advertising. If that's of interest, if you're an FHE person, then please do kind of have a look at SHEEP and see whether it's of interest to you. So what I would try to do is kind of like cover, not so quickly, so I apologize for that, quite a lot of the work that we're doing at the Institute. I didn't really touch upon some of the ethics side of things and some of the more social sciencey side of things, partly because that's not my technical background and I wouldn't do them. I would do them a disservice if I tried to explain what we're doing in the area of data ethics, but we're doing a lot on that side of the spectrum, working with lawyers, working with more other kind of philosophers, as it were, trying to kind of help the government and organisations of different kinds ensure that they use data in an ethical and kind of legally compliant manner, and changing the UK law such that we are ethically responsible in the use of data. And I think that's quite an interesting area from a cybersecurity perspective. It's something that I've recently kind of been thinking about. So I won't say anything profound at the moment, but I think it's an area that we should, as for those of you that are cybersecurity related researchers, should start to think about a little bit more than we currently perhaps do. So I'll start to segue now into a bit more of technical content. So I was kind of interested, so I joined the Alan Turing Institute for many reasons, partly because it's a kind of national institute at the UK, in the UK, and partly because of the brand of the man himself, and the brand of the university partners. And the institute essentially trades off all of those brands, and that's what gives us great convening power and also allows us to create national level impact. So I was kind of interested in Alan Turing and what he did, and so I started to read some papers of his and papers that were written about him. And it turns out, you may suspect I would say this, that Alan Turing himself, I would class him perhaps maybe not one of the first, but he's certainly one of the first data scientists that I've come across. That's through my limited kind of reading in of kind of history. He was a statistical data scientist, specifically at Bletchley Park. And why do I say that? Well, I'll give you some citations and some quotes from him to kind of demonstrate that that's partly true. But if data science is the combination of different scientific disciplines to derive value from data, then Turing and his work at Bletchley Park, essentially that's what he did. So in Hut 8, at Bletchley Park, he had linguists, he had, I guess, the kind of first computer scientists, he had hardware engineers, and quite crucially, he had Jack Good as a statistician, which was helping to guide him towards the Banner-Erasmus algorithm and all the work they did in deciphering Enigma. And so I kind of proposed that, well, rather, the literature and I proposed that Turing was a statistical data scientist, and so the Institute has quite a natural kind of link back to Turing and his work. And then if we focus in on Alan Turing's view of probability, so there is a really cool paper. So back in 2012, Alan Turing appeared on Archive, which is not something that happens every day. and when you get a notification telling you that Turing's just appeared on Archive. But GCHQ kindly openly published, declassified and openly published a paper of Turing's in 2012, and you can go on the internet and download this either from Archive, because somebody's typed it up, or you can see the original manuscript, which was handwritten. The paper by Turing, which was written in 1941, but like I say, only published in 2012, is titled The Application of Probability to Cryptography. Now, my mathematical knowledge being a statistician isn't as great as I'd like it to be, and so I don't fully, well, I actually do understand the cryptography that goes on in this paper, but I don't fully understand cryptography in any meaningful sense. But I do understand the probability side of things that he presented, thankfully. And some of the key quotes that come from this paper, that's actually, there's a great guy, a great US-based academic called Sandy Zabel, who's done quite a lot of work on the history of Turing and provided commentary on this paper. Which, so if you're interested in this paper, I suggest you also read this accompanying paper, which provides a commentary. And it's actually Sandy Zabel that pulled out some of these quotes. So this, to me, is evidence that Turing was a Bayesian, is a Bayesian, was a Bayesian, I guess, and the use of Bayesian statistics through World War II was actually the key thing that helped us to decipher Enigma and allegedly kind of, you know, win the war. And so when Bayesian statistics, you know, if I extrapolate quite a lot, Bayesian statistics and Bayesian methodology helped to win the war. And that's quite extraordinary given that Bayesian statistics in the 40s was seen as something that one should never do. And so from, you know, my hat is further off to Alan Turing for actually persevering with a Bayesian methodology in utilizing this in the way that I'll describe in a moment, at least at a high level. So Turing said in his manuscript, the probability of an event on certain evidence is the proportion of cases in that which an event may be expected to happen given that evidence. So that kind of loosely suggests that he's a Bayesian. He's thinking about conditional probabilities. That's my interpretation of that statement. But then more specifically, he talks about the evidence concerning the possibility of an event occurring usually divides into a part about which statistics are available, i.e. a likelihood function, and a less definite part about which one can only use one's judgment, i.e. prior knowledge. We combine those in a mathematically rigorous way, as you all know, because I'm sure some of you are Bayesians in this audience, or I hope you are, and we get posterior distribution. So that suggests Turing was a Bayesian. Actually, what really suggests Turing was a Bayesian was the quote, which directly states that nearly all applications of probability to cryptography depend on the factor principle or Bayes theorem. So back in 1940s, Bayesian statistics were being used, and essentially what we were computing was Bayes factors, and he introduced some cool computational tools, the Deciban. Deciban was introduced basically in the same way that us, you know, the computer scientists in the audience was use computational tricks to improve computational tractability. The Deciban was introduced back in the 40s to do exactly that. So there's some cool things that we kind of do now almost naturally as a data science community that they were doing in Hut 8 back in the 1940s, which I find quite inspirational. And again, there's another great paper by Jack Good. And this stuff, yeah, the work that they were doing in Hut 8 really started to not leak, but started to appear in the open literature around 1980s. So again, Jack Good, I have kind of infinite respect for these kinds of academics who were utilizing, you know, big proponents of these kinds of methodologies that were completely out of favor during the period, you know, during the 40s, and yet they persevered. They knew that this changed the kind of the course of the war in specific ways in which they utilized, relatively simple ways in which they utilized these methodologies. And they were constantly told by the rest of the academic community that Bayesian statistics was just not useful in any way, shape, or form. And yet they had to keep, they had to bite the lip and not actually release any of this stuff. So it's remarkable. I'm not sure I would have the self-control to be able to not leak all secrets. Maybe I shouldn't say that, actually. I have the self-control, just in case anybody's watching. so that leads me to kind of my interest, which is I want to be able to build a Bayesian model for cybersecurity, or specifically in this context, network-based cybersecurity. And I think there are four key things that we need to do. And I've not done any of these yet. I should say they're kind of right at the beginning of this journey. I'll be interested in anybody's thoughts in any of these things, and I'll allude to the kinds of problems that sits within these things. So I think the key ingredients are as follows. So chain event graph, essentially a way in which one can undertake causal specifically Bayesian analysis, but causal statistical analysis, and represents the causality between events using event trees. And this is a general chain event graphs are a generalization of event trees, for those of you that don't know them. And eliciting great expertise from people like Josh and others about cybersecurity systems, about adversaries, about how they work, about systems of systems, about supply chains, etc. Building all of that into quite a complicated statistical causal Bayesian model, using this chain event graph methodological system to represent what's going on in the real world. So that's the incorporation of prior knowledge, as it were. So I'm particularly interested in chain event graphs. I've got just started a project which is actually looking not at cybersecurity at all, but I'm hoping it will translate into that. So I've started a project using chain event graphs, which is looking at how an individual will go from kind of minor radicalization to full radicalization to kind of taking part in some kind of terrorist-related attack in, you know, Western country, and looking at the kind of sociological evolution, as it were, so an individual's psychological and the sociological kind of surroundings evolution through that path from being, you know, somebody like myself all the way through to somebody being very radicalized and out and performing an attack. And that has analogies in some respects to the kind of cybersecurity kill chain. And so I'm hoping that the learnings from that work will translate across into the cyber world. In terms of, so we've got an ability to do causal inference, assuming that this stuff works. The next thing I'm interested in is horizontally scalable inference. So I'm particularly interested in scalable statistical methods, so things that sit on top of platforms such as Spark. And what I see a lot of the time in Spark-related applications is that people like to count. And that's great. We do a lot of summarization through counting lots of things. But that's not the most sophisticated one can do with respect to statistics. So what I want to do is to get more statistical sophistication into Spark-like environments. So we're currently starting a project, an open source project that complements Spark ML, MLlib, sorry. Which is looking at placing MCMC, Markov Chain Monte Carlo related algorithms, on top of Spark. And so there's some interesting challenges that exist when you're trying to kind of perform MCMC. You've got a distributed data set across multiple machines. You're running local MCMC algorithms, computing local posterior distributions or sample-based representations of those posterior distributions. How do you combine those samples to produce a globally consistent and statistically correct MCMC algorithm, or rather representation, asymptotically correct representation of the posterior distribution. And that's what this project's all about. So we just started quite a big project. It's a collaboration between Cambridge, Warwick, Oxford and Bristol and the Turing Institute on just that topic. And the best thing we've come up with so far is quite a cool rejection sampling algorithm, which uses perfect sampling and all kinds of things. We'll be publishing that very shortly. Computationally, it's horrendous. Even though it sits on Spark, so we have the horizontal scalability, it takes quite a while just to do one MCMC iteration. So there's still quite a lot of research to do in this space, but we do have ideas around how we can kind of speed these things up. Handling time variant for Anonymo, I mentioned earlier on that I'm interested in things as function time, sequential Monte Carlo, et cetera, and that's kind of going to be the focus of the last few slides that I've got in a moment, and some point process work that I've been doing using Markov modulated Poisson processes, which Josh has seen now about three times this presentation, so I apologize, Josh. And then finally, I think the final key ingredient of a good cybersecurity model or a good cyber data science related system should be that the techniques are privacy preserving. So I mentioned homomorphic encryption. We just kicked off another project which is looking at FHE-based algorithms and essentially trying to produce homomorphically, that's not the correct phrase, HE algorithms that are classification algorithms. So for instance, there's been a paper that demonstrates a logistic regression algorithm that is fully homomorphic encryption compliant, if that's the correct phrase. We want to take that a bit further, so that's, logistic regression is kind of useful, but it's not the most sophisticated thing we can do. So how do we take that project and you go to the kind of the next class of statistical classification algorithm using homomorphic encryption? So this project's known as CryptoML, and again, we're looking for collaboration opportunities on that project too. So that's a collaboration, actually it's just a collaboration between the Heilbronn Institute of Mathematical Research, which is based in Bristol, and Warwick University, as it stands, and the Turing Institutes. So for me, if we can combine all of these four things, we have ability to kind of respect people's privacy and utilize as much of their data on the different end user devices as possible, but respect the privacy. We can handle time variant phenomena. We can operate at scale when we're looking across computers, and we can incorporate prior knowledge. If I can combine these disparate things, and they're still disparate as it stands today, then I think we've got quite a cool system. I don't know how far away in terms of time we are from this, but this is kind of my vision, and this is the work that I've kicked off and the work that I'm doing personally. And I hope to integrate all of these and stand here in, say, 5 years' time and give you a much better presentation. I remember when I studied here 5 years ago. Now I've integrated all these. This is the system that I've come up with. It's all open source. Please rip it apart and tell me where I can improve it. And if you think any of those ideas are wrong, or you've got any complimentary ideas, or you just want to chat to me, then again, my email address is at the end. I'd welcome the opportunity to chat to you via Skype or Zoom or wherever you are. I guess Skype would be the favorite tool here.
Teams,
okay. So I believe some of my colleagues from Imperial have spoken here before, so I won't repeat their presentation. So I'm now focusing on a little project that I did with one of my students at Imperial College around the use of NetFlow data, analyzing NetFlow data, and trying to understand user behavior on a particular device using a particular class of model, point process model, known as a Markov modulated Poisson process, and show you some results. So I'm kind of, the presentation really started off quite broad in terms of the Turing Institutes, and I'm just narrowing it down to this particular NetFlow based analysis. So we at Imperial College collect NetFlow data. We have about 40,000 computers. We generate about 12 terabytes of flow data per month, or around 15 gigabytes per hour. And the kinds of things we're interested in, so we're interested in people trying to steal our intellectual property, because for Imperial, that's one of the ways in which we can generate revenue and obviously then fund the academic research that we want to undertake and the training that we do. We don't want to impose lots of constraints on the network. Academics get grumpy when you tell them they can't go and visit a particular website, no matter what that website is. And students in college halls really don't like being told that they can't use the latest illegal file sharing tool. Not that anybody does that at Imperial College, I'm sure, but I'm, yeah. that's a consideration too. And spear phishing turns out, as often the case, is a major compromise route for the network. And I guess the fourth thing, which is always the case with cybersecurity, the brand damage that one could incur if there were a successful attack, or if such an attack was reported. I'm sure there has been several successful attacks, we just don't know about them. So I guess some of you will know this stuff, but a NetFlow record is a summary between two network devices, and it's collected at the router level. There's quite a lot of interest in statistical issues around missing data, around duplication, around direction, around time, around sessionization. There's lots of change going on. And there's lots of ways in which you can analyze the data. So NetFlow data is really cool data set from a statistical perspective. If you're just interested in developing statistical methodology, and that's kind of my interest really, then this offers quite a lot of different statistical problems to motivate the methodological developments that one can undertake. And the great data set that Los Alamos National Labs release is a great data set for everybody to kind of access, but I'm sure at MSR you have access to some great data too. So maybe you don't need that open source data, but I will advertise the Los Alamos data, not least because I'm visiting Los Alamos next week, and if anybody's watching this, they will be pleased that I've advertised their data set. So given NetFlow data, i.e. given metadata about the packets flying across the network, what I want to do is just analyze an individual device. And I want to model user behavior. So I want to know, just from the timing information of the events on a computer, can I figure out what the user was doing, i.e. were they streaming, were they on, not necessarily were they on YouTube, but were they streaming video, were they writing emails, were they doing nothing at all, what kinds of activity were they doing? So I want to kind of infer that using a Bayesian process. And the Bayesian process I chose to use is a Markov modulated Poisson process. So what is an MMPP? Well, really simply, what we've got is a, so this is some of the kind of more formal detail, but I won't go through this in the interest of time. What we have is a hidden, a latent continuous time Markov chain, which is denoting, or rather representing the user behavior. So we've got a finite state, continuous time Markov chain. And so if the chain is in state zero, the user's inactive. If the state is in chain one, if the chain is in state one, then perhaps they're on streaming, video streaming websites and so on and so forth. So we have some interesting challenges there, both in terms of specifying the number of states. So we've got a model selection problem, linking it back to Alan Turing's work in model selection and Bayes factors and all that good stuff. So once we've solved that problem, then we have an inference problem. We have, we want to infer the state, i.e., you know, what are they doing on the computer? And all our likelihood function is essentially a point process model, a Poisson point process model, where we get the event timing data. And from that event timing data, we want to infer this, the state of this continuous time Markov chain. And there's some stuff on continuous time Markov chains, which I will skip over because you're either interested in it and you know it, or you're not interested in it and it's dull maths that nobody really cares about, but interesting maths nevertheless. The kind of key contribution that we made, so the first one was from an application perspective. We were able to kind of, as you'll see on the next slide, we were able to demonstrate that one can infer some stuff from using these types of methodologies. The second contribution that we made was in terms of parameter estimation. And so from a methodological perspective, in that continuous time Markov chain, what you want to do is to estimate a bunch of parameters, or two parameters, which are reasonable dimension, depending on the number of hidden states that you have in this continuous time Markov chain. And you can do that using EM or Gibbs sampling, so it's all relatively straightforward. But from a an estimation perspective, what you need to be able to do is to construct the smooth distribution. So if you're state-based modeling, if you are trying to compute the posterior distribution as a function of time, as you get more and more data, what you need to be able to do is to compute this distribution conditional on all the data. And I've omitted lots and lots of details, but it's in the accompanying paper. What one realizes is that when you're computing the smoothing distribution, you run a filter forwards across the data in time, you run a filter backwards in time, and you combine the outputs at the different points in time. This backwards filter is actually not a probability measure. In fact, it needn't be necessarily a finite measure. And so when you use sequential Monte Carlo related techniques, which you have to use in this particular case, to estimate these distributions because the solution don't admit an analytically tractable solution, this estimation of this measure, which is not necessarily a finite measure, means that these techniques, all the convergence theory, goes out of the window. And so the methodological contribution that we made in this particular paper was to guarantee that this is the backward filter is a finite measure, at the very least by introducing an artificial distribution. We did some probabilistic manipulations to kind of remove the effect of some artificial distribution that we introduce and make this whole system computable using the types of methodology, sequential Monte Carlo, that we have to use, which is then embedded in a parameter estimation algorithm to estimate the parameters. So it's parameter estimation is very computationally expensive. Once you estimate the parameters, the actual algorithm to infer this stuff, to infer the state of the user, is actually relatively straightforward. So we got, just to kind of reiterate, we got point process data. We want to estimate the state of this hidden state, i.e. what's the user doing, and we use a relatively simple algorithm to be able to do that, this Markov modulated Poisson process algorithm, to estimate the probability of the state at any one particular time. Prior to that, we have to estimate the parameters of the system. We use, in our case, we used Gibbs sampling, but within that Gibbs sampling procedure, we needed a sequential Monte Carlo algorithm, and we realized that there was this technical problem about this backwards filter not necessarily approximating a finite measure, and so we solve that particular problem as well. And so that's the methodological contribution then gets applied in the cybersecurity context. In this particular case, I think we went for a four-state continuous time Markov chain, but I was methodologically it generalizes. Practically, if you go beyond 10 states, then you're probably going to be waiting a few weeks for your results to actually be, you know, to be usable. Very good question. So one was emailing, one was doing nothing, one was streaming, and the fourth one was on Microsoft Word. So a little advertisement for your organization. just to see. I can't remember what, I think these are the different, so the different colors represent the different types of activity to be undertaken. So what we did was to get the student to do different activities. He kind of recorded the ground truth. And then we accessed his NetFlow data from his device from the college. And so this is the count of NetFlow data, I think, binned over a five-minute time period. Or it might be a minute. I can't remember now the exact details. And so that's the NetFlow data. And these are the results. I think what we do here is just focus in on one part of that data just to make that make it visible. So these are the different states. This blue line here is the map estimate of the state that we believe the device to be in. If you believe me, then the estimated state is often consistent, not always, but often consistent with the actual true state, which I didn't believe to be true. So I didn't think this was actually going to work. I just thought it was a cool methodological problem. And it was a hammer that I had in my back pocket at the time, and I thought, let's try it out. But actually, we were able to infer the true state of the user on this particular device. We don't have any other ground truth, so I don't know how well it generalizes. But this, for me, is a particularly kind of important piece of the jigsaw in this larger Bayesian model that I was talking about, being able to infer what the user's doing from just from NetFlow data with an associated kind of representation of the uncertainty is a key ingredient in building out this system-based representation and understanding what's going on in the system.
Mark, do you remember which process state corresponded to which activity in this?
Not off the top of my head. I'd have to go back to the paper. I don't remember off the top of my head.
I'm sort of wondering why Microsoft Word would generate network data.
Yeah,
I was curious about that too. And so, you know, you could discriminate Microsoft Word from no activity in the data.
There's an online version of Word.
That must be what it is.
They could, there's
several online versions of Word, in fact, I think.
Yeah.
Okay.
It could well be the or the OneDrive related kind of syncing that it does. So I don't think we're using the kind of, you know, you go to Chrome or Explorer or whatever you use and use the online Word, but I think there is quite a lot of sync going on in the background.
Sure.
Yeah.
Okay.
These days, at the very least.
If you have a bad network, horrible things happen if your stuff is in OneDrive.
Yeah.
So therefore, it must be using a network.
So that's all I wanted to talk about with respect to that, and I'm conscious that I'm running out of time, but just to reiterate, so the Turing Institute is the UK's national level institute for data science. Thankfully, Turing's appreciation of Bayes helped to change the world for the better, and I say Turing, but actually Jack Good's contribution as the statistician in the team is shouldn't be underestimated. As I'm sure many of you in the audience know, there are many interesting Bayesian challenges still to be solved. I've kind of alluded to some of them in my presentation, and those are the kinds of things, the activities that were undertaken specifically under my direction. And as you know, big data or deep learning, deep reinforcement learning, deep something, does not necessarily mean that statistical or expert knowledge is not needed. And so I'm still going to fly the Bayesian flag, even in the world of deep learning. The deep learning community and people that I know in the deep learning community are kind of cutting onto that and trying to integrate expert knowledge into the systems that they're developing. In this presentation, I introduced a very simple Bayesian model. It's not quite what I wanted to present. It's not quite what I wanted to do in terms of it's not as far as I'd like it to be, but I still think it's quite cool and we've solved some interesting problems. I hope this has demonstrated to an extent the kinds of work that we're doing puts Turing Institute at the forefront of research in modeling and inference, and specifically Bayesian modeling and inference. We have quite a strong community in Bayesian statistics. And for me personally, I think, you know, I always think it's good that an institute should be recognized for doing something quite well, like the Vector Institute, in my mind, is great at deep learning, primarily because of the people they've got associated with that institute. For me, we've got some really great Bayesian people, and I'd like the institute to be kind of famous for Bayesian-related statistics, but again, that's partly because I'm biased in terms of my background. But I think it has quite a nice segue to many different attributes of Alan Turing, but specifically his work in probability theory. And then finally, as I mentioned, collaborations, visits, presentations are welcome for me, from me personally. Come and visit me, or come and visit any of our academic community, and I'll set up those interactions. We can do that virtually, or we can do that physically. I welcome interactions of any kind. These are my two email addresses. Please do email us, or if you're that inclined, follow us on Twitter. But thank you for your time today, and I welcome any questions you may have.
It's a model selection problem. It's tough, right? So you know, the MetFlow, it's all over the place. Some of the edges have humans on them, and others are just purely machine-driven, and they look a lot different. You know, some are bursty, or switched. There's a Markov process. Others are very smooth. So can you talk a little about how you approach model selection there?
In that case, I've not approached it, but what would I do? I would probably come up with some kind of hierarchical representation so that I have an indicator as to the type of device that the machine is. So when I'm performing the statistical inference in the way that I described, I would condition on my inferred state of that machine, i.e. is it a server, is it an access device, is it whatever. Is it some cloud-based bespoke thing doing something weird? And so I would produce an additional level of abstraction, introduce another latent variable in the true Bayesian way, and solve that particular problem there.
That's very consistent with what I think as well. Then there's this problem you run into before that, which is figuring out all the different categories that might be involved in the mixture. So is it just servers and laptops, or is it printers, laptops and servers, or you know, what is the sort of resolution at which you want to have the mixture be resolved to?
Yeah.
And you can do this with users and machines and processes. All of these have sort of a mixture behavior to them. So
yeah, and that's where interactions. That's where the human dimension does come in, and expert knowledge. You need to talk to the guys that own the network. And at least get their view on what's on the network. They may obviously not always know what's on the network, but I think having those interactions, you can then better model the world and incorporate the uncertainty associated with those models. So again, I'll kind of re-advocate the Bayesian methodology. I feel like I've hammered that point a little bit too much today. I am pragmatic most of the time, but as long as it's a Bayesian solution.
So you talked about using fully homomorphic encryption, and actually I'm impressed that someone got logistic regression to work there. It seems like it should be really hard because exponentiation is not a ring operation.
Mm-hmm.
So you can evaluate using fully homomorphic encryption if you want to do this in some privacy-preserving way. Of course, then you don't get to know the answer to your thing you evaluated for someone. But you can only do that if you get the model from somewhere. And I was wondering if you had any thoughts about how that might be done in a privacy-preserving way. There's hope that one might be able to build a model using encrypted data, but it's a ways off, and the data has to all be encrypted with the same key in all the schemes I've heard.
So no is the short answer, because I rely on my my colleagues to do that work for me, or with me. So no, I don't have a sensible answer to that question, so I'll avoid the question completely, and hopefully if any of my colleagues are watching, then they can email me and say, this is what the answer to that question should have been. So no, I can't give you an answer to that question.
One takeaway is we're very interested in homomorphic encryption, right?
Yeah.
So that's probably a real key collaboration opportunity.
Yeah.
Okay.
There are some awesome experts in this building.
Sadly, I'm not one of them. I don't have that expertise.
I'm not either, actually. I'm
more mathematically minded than me, by the sound of it. So.
So, can you talk more about Spark on SGX? SGX. Well, you were
running Spark on SGX.
Yes, that's right. So Spark sitting on top of an SGX compliant Linux kernel library. So if you Google...
So you're running Spark inside of SGX.
Components of Spark, so we had to rewrite Spark, or rather, we had to SGXify some specific parts of Spark. So the project really was about identifying which parts of Spark needed to be inside the SGX enclave and which parts didn't need to be. And so we had to make some subtle changes to the Spark code base.
So you're trying to be training or eval or both?
So what we're trying to do is have a Spark environment so the users can do whatever they want on top of it, just writing standard code and Spark SGX. The Spark SGX compliant version, you know, the user's invariant to the fact that it's got SGX sitting behind it. So as a person that, you know, doesn't want to have to worry about the kind of kernel-ish level operations that one has to kind of undertake to get SGX to actually do anything, I can just sit there, write my Scala code in Spark as I normally would, and be fairly confident that the SGX side of things will be taken care of through this Linux kernel library and the Spark modifications that sit on top of that SGX LKL.
Do you have any estimates on how the performance is related to the SGX version?
From memory, I think there's a kind of 5x performance penalty using SGX, but I believe Intel are making some changes to the next firmware release, which should help us with that. There's still issues with SGX around side channel attacks and roughly that will always exist. But I guess Intel aren't claiming that those side channels don't exist. So we're not fully secure in the way that I described, but you know, nothing ever is. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So yeah, there's a couple of papers again on our website, and all this, the software now is open sourced, so if you're interested then grab it and spot bugs and contribute and all the other good stuff.
I think I mentioned the MCMC on Spark.
Yeah.
So what kind of performance speed did you get on that?
We don't at present. So we get a significant, and I mean significant, kind of reduction in computational performance, but at least we can then parallelize across multiple machines. So at the moment, I would argue that one can't do anything at all on Spark with MCMC. You can. There's a couple of attempts at this using kind of kernel-based approximations, placing Gaussian kernels over the samples and then combining those in a, I'll call it from my perspective, a rather kind of ad hoc way. So one can do stuff, but that there's no asymptotic kind of relationship. There's no guarantees that asymptotically those approximations mean anything as you combine all of these different approximations. So what we're trying to do is be statistically principled when we combine these different local approximations. But the penalty for that at the moment is that costs you a lot more computationally. And so the next challenge is, well, actually, how do we improve the computational performance of these quite horrific rejection sampling-related approaches that we've proposed? So that's what we'll be doing next. But in the meantime, kind of open sourcing all these implementations so that at least, you know, if you have the time to wait and you care about kind of being statistically principled, then you have an ability to do something.
The Spark open source community, you welcome these types of efforts?
I don't know. We've only communicated to the statistical community at present. I guess I need to go to the Spark conference. I can't remember what it's called now, but the thing that happens every now and again, and present it to them there and see what they say. The statistical community seem to welcome it, but whether the Spark community, whether they're just happy with, you know, the kind of out of the box machine learning based algorithms, and a lot of the stuff seems to be SGD related, stochastic gradient descent related, and that may well be good enough, and point estimates for everything may well be good enough for a lot of the applications, and so this stuff's not going to be relevant to a lot of the community, but for those that actually want to perform a full Bayesian statistical analysis, which tends to be the case in my experience in bioinformatics, then this stuff will be of use. So the kind of, you know, Winbugs type community, that community will hopefully be able to translate and use this type of technology relatively easily. The other thing I should say is that we're hoping, I think I can say this, we are going to be hosting a PPL, probabilistic programming language workshop in next year. So we've got the STAN community coming across, We have Uber have a tool which Pyro, I think it's called, a PPL language, which I think sits on top of the JVM. Can't remember now. But so we're getting a number of different communities across, and hopefully this stuff will be presented. It's not a PPL, but it's kind of heading towards that direction, which is why I mentioned that. Again, if there's any, I don't know what Microsoft's doing in the PPL space, if I'm totally honest. But if there's any interest in, you know, from the community in PPLs, then welcome your involvement in that workshop too. Thank you very much.